Hello, everyone, and welcome. My name is Dayan Huff, Director of Public Programs at the Studio Museum in Harlem. We are so grateful to be collaborating with MoMA for today's program, What Makes Me So Black and Blur, after Armstrong, Ellington, Moten, Tate, and Waller, featuring Erica N. Cardwell, Gabrielle Civil, Kenturah Davis, and Shala Miller. This conversation marks the second of three public programs that Studio Museum and MoMA have collaborated on in support of the exhibition Projects Ming Smith, a Studio Museum MoMA collaboration on view at MoMA until May 29th. The entire series is a multi-sensory exploration of Harlem-based photographer Ming Smith's use of the blur over her four decades long career. When this program's title was being reviewed, our editor asked if there should be a question mark. I replied, no, it's not a question, a plea, or a woe, but a statement, a declaration, an elevation. By transforming Fats Waller's original song title, What Did I Do to Be So Black and Blue, into What Makes Me So Black and Blur, we control the gaze. We center ourselves, we define our why and how for being and seeing in the ways that empower us, protect us, and inspire us. So for this program, we invited a multidisciplinary cohort of creatives who, like Smith, are hyphenates in their respective practices to explore how the blur resonates within their own work. The program will consist of our moderator and panelists, each providing an offering, responding to Smith's photographs. They'll then engage in a group conversation, and if time allows, we'll take a few questions from you. But before we formally introduce tonight's featured participants, I'd like to pass things to my colleague, MoMA's Adelia Gregory, to join me in welcoming all of you and to share some additional notes.
Thank you, Dayan. Hello, everyone. My name is Adelia, and I'm part of the public engagement team at MoMA, and I am so happy to share the space with all of you tonight. It has been a deep privilege and joy to be in collaboration and conversation with Dayan and Moses Villanueva from the Studio Museum in Harlem, and especially Naomi Amenu-Faseha and Brianna Harlan, two wonderful joint fellows at Studio Museum and MoMA who shared in the development and shaping of this event together. I'm pleased to just share a few notes that we hope will make this experience tonight as accessible as possible. First, thanks to Christina and Juni of Pro Bono ASL, American Sign Language interpretation is available for tonight's program. If you plan to use the ASL interpretation, we recommend pinning the captioners video screen so that they stay clearly visible for you. We are recording this conversation, and so if you have to duck out a little bit early, we understand, and please rest assured that the video will be on MoMA and Studio's event pages very soon. The chat, we will use the chat tonight as a shared space, and we invite you and encourage you to use it to share love for what you're hearing and seeing, pose thoughts, questions, and to request any kind of technical assistance. As you do share, just a gentle reminder to make sure that you also leave and create space for others to do the same. We are a large international gathering tonight, intentionally so. And there may be times when others share experiences that are dissimilar to yours. And in all of our programs, we encourage you to honor the lived experiences of others. And just fair warning, we will definitely not tolerate any behavior or language that abuses anyone. We will have the Q&A box open as well. So if you have specific questions for the panelists, if all goes to plan, we do expect our colleague Naomi to pop up towards the end and voice a few of those questions aloud. Naomi and Moses will also be dropping links and resources into the chat throughout the evening. And so please don't worry if you miss any of those. We'll also collect all of them and send them to you afterwards in an email after the program. And now I'm very pleased to pass things back to Dayan to share more about tonight's panelists.
Thank you, Adelia. Now, what I'll be sharing does not do our incredible panelists justice, but for the sake of time, I'll be offering heavily abbreviated bios. Full bios can be found on our respective websites. Gabrielle Civil is a Black feminist performance artist, poet, and writer originally from Detroit, like Ming Smith. She has premiered over 50 performance artworks around the world. The aim of her work is to open up space. Kenturah Davis is an artist working between Los Angeles and Accra, Ghana. Her work oscillates between various facets of portraiture and design. Using text as a point of departure, she explores the fundamental role that language has in shaping how we understand ourselves and the world around us. This manifests in a variety of forms, including drawings, textiles, sculpture, and performances. Shala Miller, also known as Freddie June when she sings, was born and raised in Cleveland, Ohio, by two Southerners named Al and Ruby. Miller's work in photography and film mediates on the intersection of desire, mourning, pain, and pleasure. Taking up skin as a site of history and intimacy with the self and across generations, they hold space for the body's vulnerabilities and maladies. And finally, tonight's moderator, Erica N. Cardwell, is a writer, critic, and educator based in Brooklyn and Toronto. Erica's teaching and writing consider the consciousness and imaginations of people of color as a tool for social, spiritual, and collective movement. She centers Black feminist theory as her primary critical approach, and often writes about print and papermaking practices, archival media, and interdisciplinary performance. And with that, I am so excited to invite Erica to lead us on. Erica.
Thank you, Dayan and Adelia. Hello, everyone. Thank you for spending your Tuesday evening with us. I will begin by thanking the Studio Museum in Harlem and the Museum of Modern Art for bringing us together. Specifically, I would love to name our fantastic team, Dayan Huff, Adelia Gregory, Naomi Amenu-Faseha, Jose Camacho, and our interpreters and the entire AV team. I would also like to offer a special thank you to Ming Smith. It is truly an honor to gather on the occasion of your exhibition, Projects Ming Smith. Our focus this evening is specifically tailored to the blur, the pixelated, fragmentary, luscious light that Ming Smith is known for in her photographs of us, Black people. Ming Smith sees us, and that seeing is a loving homage to our wholeness and a sense of place. Harlem, most certainly, but with regard to her Invisible Man series, Ming has said, Harlem is everywhere. Tonight, myself and the panelists will discuss the blur, Ming's blur, and the ways it overlaps within our work. In a conversation for Aperture Magazine between Arthur Jaffa and Greg Tate on the work of Ming Smith, Tate describes the blur as an artistic and political strategy and as a mode of protection. Jaffa adds that the blur erases much of the distinction between foreground and background. Now, I consider myself to write as a Black feminist art critic, and I find the project of my work is to consider visual art and culture using the framework of Black feminist theory and tradition. Black feminism centralizes the interiority of Black women, the hybrid nature of our creativity and opacity as an aesthetic principle. I consider my work to be a kind of poetics of criticism, one intent on elevating Black women artists in a contemporary conversation of critical inquiry within the art world in recognition of the ways we cannot be and refuse to be read, seen, or understood. To consider opacity as both protection and strategy aligns the work of Ming Smith with Black feminist tradition, a space where hybrid forms and interiority luxuriate in places of play and curiosity with certainty, and where self can be examined without disruption. Opacity, therefore, can exist as memoir, which might be another way of saying that while opacity is deliberate, it is also what we must see first. Strategy and protection continue to rise to the surface, hovering and enclosing me with ideas. Quickly, I jot down prompts inspired by my co-panelists. I begin with the blur as point of view. I'm reminded of the moment in the middle of a conversation when a friend blurts out an excited conjecture, or a distorted billboard of multiple advertisements, overlapping, peeled, illegible. There's also the simplicity of an ink stain on a well-worn bag. How does the ink preserve its wear? A smattering and a distortion, but also visual evidence of effort, of breath, of time. The stain is, in fact, the wear. When I was invited to ruminate on the work of Ming Smith in conversation with Gabrielle Civil, Kenturah Davis, and Shala Miller. The blur began to appear within their work with a sudden clarity and an intimacy where it had been all along, everywhere. I stand transfixed by the photo, Circular Breathing, where we see poet Hart Leroy Bibbs at a table in Paris. Upon initial look, Circular Breathing could be perceived as a stolen moment. I think the photo will appear here soon. His eyes remain wide and unstirred despite the flash of light. One wonders if Bibbs and Ming were in conversation. The fire from his lighter illuminates his face, adding dimension to shadow, a felt sense more interesting yet harder to capture, but somehow we feel it too. We also observe the sadness coating Bibbs' eyes, its own shimmering blur, heavy sorrow recognizable. Another question arrives, but this one involves the subject. Did they feel it too? The blur as intimacy. The use of the long exposure might mean that the photographer remains in front of their subject for several moments after the image was captured. The long exposure might mean that intimacy, potentially brief, is essential to Ming's blur in order to capture a sustained point of view. The long exposure might mean that when we look at Woman in the Kitchen, for example, we ask ourselves, where was Ming? The long exposure reminds us that images are made and that making can occur simply between our eyes and the subject. In our conversation this evening, I'm interested in the ways that Ming's blur might occur as an organizing principle. How does Ming's blur deliver the subjectivity of herself and her subjects? How does Ming's blur exhibit care for Black people? Fred Moten wrote in his book, Black and Blur, invisibility, let me explain, gives one a slightly different sense of time. You're never quite on the beat. Sometimes you're ahead, and sometimes you're behind. A few nights ago, as I wrote this, I glanced over at my computer and a tiny alert in the bottom right corner read, "The sunset is coming." The sweet blue song Daydream by Betty Carter enveloped the background. Daydream, why do you haunt me so? Deep in a rosy glow, the face of my love you show. Daydream, I walk along the air, building a castle there for me and my love to share. Throughout the evening, we will move through a few more prompts, engaging in a poetics of criticism with Ming's blur. The blur as spirit, the blur as concealment, the blur as wonder. We'll begin with Gabrielle Civil, who will share her offering on Ming Smith.
Thank you so much. It is truly a pleasure to be here. And we can lower this beautiful slide of circular breathing now. Thank you. Let's start with the blur in the body. I can't see you, so you don't need to be inhibited. Where is the blur in your body right now? Feel it. Let's start with a score. Our blurs, Ming's and mine, begin with vibration, begin with shimmy and undulation, begin with the glisten of blackness. Invite flame, strike a match, shake it, spread smoke, collapse the visual and spiritual plane. Experience Ming's blur. Do you still feel it in your body? Try again. Let's look at our blurs, Ming's and mine. Look, Zoom was nice to me. It's letting me show a few slides. So, okay, here we go. Ming's blur, cascading light, 1981. Ming's blur, Ming's magic, Ming's motion, Ming's conjure of jazz, Ming's mode of representation. Not hiding or hidden, Ming's enveloping of spirit, streaking light, Ming's emanation from the Latin, emanare, meaning to flow from, to pour forth or out of. In cosmology, Ming's meaning, meaning Ming's black and blue. Ah, Ming's blur, Sun Ra Space 2, New York, 1978. Take a minute and look. Take a minute and feel. Take a minute and listen. Tina Camp would approve. Vibration and frequency. Ming's blur here is a glittery streak of elemental energy in the visual and spiritual field. Can't you feel earth and water here? Cool fire and air. Now a turban over Sun Ra's head, now a shawl of stars around his neck. Ming's blur again, as emanation flowing from, pouring out of Ming's blur as aura, adorning the cosmic shaman. Greg Tate calls the blur a mode of protection. We see protection here. We feel protection here. We hear protection here on a visual, spiritual plane. Ming Smith beholds, holds dear, holds clear, holds back a little. Ming Smith beholds Sun Ra, emanates, and in the background, somebody's playing a flute, somebody's playing a horn, somebody's playing a drum, and sonic particles float in the frame like stardust. My blur. You like blurry pictures, my friend Allison said to me. She's not wrong. I like things porous or dissolving, counter to fixed, something between motion picture and still, video and photo. In performance, videos don't capture what happens in a show. Videos don't capture what happens in a show. Videos only show what happens looks like. What happens looks like is a deja vu, is a blur. My blur isn't precise like Ming's blur. The amazing thing about Ming's blur is Ming's blur actually isn't blurry. Ming's blur actually isn't blurry. My blur is more blurry. My blur is out of focus sometimes. My blur is amorphous shape. My blur is interior memory. My blur is this photo of me by Sage Carroll from Comedy and Other Work, a performance in 2006. This photo of me by Sage Carroll captures something of my blur, how I feel inside performance, how I feel performance time is a blur that becomes a flashback, a portal in my book, The Deja Vu, Black Dreams and Black Time. This photo nestled between black pages in black and white. A flashback is another kind of blur, another kind of black and blue time, like the foam of the Atlantic lapping around my legs. This photo of me by Fungi Maturori from my performance, Fugue, Dissolution Accra 2012, captures my blur, the blur of diasporic memory, diasporic witness and grief, an embodied visual and spiritual plane, historically speaking, a very long exposure. Look at the spray of water connecting the surf to the mirror. Feel the spray of water connecting the surf to the mirror. Listen to the spray of water connecting the surf to the mirror, an emanation flowing from the Black Atlantic, pouring out of history. Doesn't it remind you of Ming's blur in cascading light? How can a Black body be remembered and move through the world? How can an image be both kinetic and still? Our blur synthesizes action and reflection, body and setting, symbol and sight. Arthur Jaffa says, the blur blurs the foreground and the background. I want to say the black ground. And behold, in this photo, August Blues Harlem, New York, 1991, we become wall, we become shadow, we become channel, we become poster, we become pattern, we become walk, we become streetlight or moon, we become then and now, a photograph and a poem on Zoom. Ming's blur captures our re-metabolizing on the visual and spiritual plane. Thank you. And now, Kenturah Davis will share her offering on Ming Smith. Thank you very much.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Kenturah, and I'm here in Los Angeles. I'm very honored to be a part of this conversation and kind of meditation on Ming Smith's work. I would like to share some images, starting with Ming Smith. So I'd also like to spend some time thinking and looking at this work, Cascading Light. And I've been in sort of a phase of my own kind of life and practice of thinking about shadows in particular. One thing that kind of stood out to me and what Gabrielle shared, which was really powerful, is again this focus on blur and a specific line that I really love by Fred Moten, blur in the interest of precision. And so that really sings to me following what Gabrielle offered to us. So I wanna read an excerpt from an essay that I've been writing and adding to. Talks about shadows and time and memory. Shadows exemplify a contingent condition. In one context, shadows can signify mystery, obscurity, and danger, while in another context, it offers a condition that reveals. When the ancient Egyptians developed their hieroglyphs, the inscriptions into clay and stone were invitations for the appearance of shadows. Even the smallest or shallowest grooves delineated meaning in material, with marks made visible by virtue of their shadows. The conditions of the light animates the surfaces. By the way, light has momentum and energy, thus subtly disturbing and rearranging everything it touches. Physicist Karen Barad points out that whenever we flip on a light, the furniture moves ever so slightly. Change in the quantum landscape is an event. Everything has a duration. Toni Morrison conjured Zora Neale Hurston's proclamation in her essay titled Sites of Memory. Like, quote, like the dead seeming cold rocks, I have memories within that came out of the material that went to make me. Time and place have had their say. So you will have to know something about the time and place where I come from in order that you may interpret the incidents and directions of my life. Physicist Carlo Rovelli also affirms Hurston's statements, in part by dissecting the conventional understanding about the nature of time. Time is legion, he says. If there is such thing as time, independent from us, its versions are innumerable. Every phenomena and point in space has its own time, its specific. He explains, quote, the hardest stone, in light of what we have learned from chemistry, from physics, from mineralogy, from geology, and from psychology, is in reality a complex vibration of quantum fields, a momentary interaction of forces, a process that for a brief moment manages to keep its shape, to hold itself in equilibrium before disintegrating again into dust. A brief chapter in the history of interactions between the elements of the planet, a trace of Neolithic humanity, a weapon used by kids, an example in a book about time, a metaphor for an ontology, a part of a segmentation of the world that depends more on how our bodies are structured to perceive than on the object of perception, and gradually an intricate knot in that cosmic game of mirrors that constitutes reality. The world is not so much made of stones as of fleeting sounds or of waves moving through the sea, end quote. So another thing that I'm interested in is how we perceive the world. And I think Ming Smith does something that brings to the surface things that are easy to take for granted. One thing I think about often is the fact that there's a valley between what we see and perceive in the world and the world itself. So I want to share a work that embraces and celebrates the principles that are embodied in Ming Smith's work, particularly this piece, as was again beautifully sort of delivered in Gabrielle's offering. This image has a kind of fluidity and swirl and engages it with the kind of duration. Something that I really love about the blurred image, the long exposure, is that it offers a kind of context. It accounts for the air. There's this idea that if you have a cup that's half full, it's half full, rather than thinking about it as full, the other space or the quote unquote negative space being full of air. These images that Ming Smith makes account for the air, accounts for context. It dissolves the distinction between the figure and the ground in a way that I think is really powerful. It slows your looking. So in an image like this, we see figures, we're searching, and there's this play between their surroundings and themselves. And I think we're always engaging with people in a state of motion as animated beings. And so these kinds of photographs offer a sort of revelation through darkness and shadows about our visual and sensory experience. I'm going to share a set of images that kind of reflect on the way I work, and again, the way I embrace the principles that are apparent in Ming Smith's work. And the ones I chose also celebrate a former studio museum artist in residence, Lauren Halsey. And I just also want to briefly celebrate her. She just opened her rooftop installation at the Met. We spent some time together a few years ago where I photographed her and her partner, and sort of embracing the idea of the possibilities of the long exposure, the possibilities of conveying the durational experience of spending time with this person. And so I'm sharing a range of the photos that came through that extended time together. And through these long exposures, each one offers something different and revelatory about that this kind of engagement. And as was mentioned before, a long exposure not only accounts for who's being viewed in the lens of a camera, but also accounts for the mover of the person holding the camera. So in many of these, the results of these images are both a kind of collaboration between my movement and Lauren's. And so I started making these long exposures, which really expanded the way I work, and began using them as references for drawings. And so I usually make hundreds of photos and have the opportunity to sort of sift through these range of images and delighted by what each one sort of tells me or offers to me. And there's this sort of doubling that affirms this possibility that's offered with a state of blur. And so here's a sort of process shot in the making of this drawing. I render drawings by writing. I think of writing as a kind of drawing. So for this particular piece, I use rubber stamp letters to stamp out a text in repetition to render this image. And in thinking about Lauren's own practice, the phrase I use to render this image is shadows as the architecture of the visual field. And knowing her own interest in architecture, it felt apropos. There's another element that often is hard to see in images. It really takes seeing them in person, but this sort of subtle embossment that you see in the panels that I have not begun the drawing yet. And then this is the completed drawing. So to go back to thinking about Ming's work and what it means to me, and the sort of the way I embrace her work and the way that I work, I think about the way we typically encounter photos as a kind of proposition for a fixed index or record of a precise moment. Blur complicates that proposition. It, as I mentioned, accounts for the air, dissolves for the figure-ground relationship. It's a witness for the periphery. At all times when we're looking around, there's this, we have a periphery, and it's as we sort of shift our gaze, new things come into focus. The blurred image does something to account for that range in the visual experience. accounting for what we may want to focus on and accounting for the periphery. And so that is my offering, and I'm happy, very happy to now introduce Shala Miller, who will offer or share her own offering on Ming Smith. Thank you.
Thank you, Kenturah, and thank you for your offering, and Gabrielle as well, and Erica. Hello, I am Shala, and I am going to share my screen.
Where did you get your ideas from?
Your ideas? Oh, man, I got a million dreams. That's all I do is dream all the time.
I thought you played piano.
No, this is not piano. This is dreaming.
So I'd like to begin by sharing a few journal entries that I had wrote as my father's health was declining, which led to his eventual death in September of 2019. May 1st, 2019. In my dream last night, my parents' home was attached to a big mall. I was watching after my dad. Everything is fuzzy now, but I remember my dad laying at the edge of the bed, getting ready to sleep. My mother's dresser with the big mirror attached was behind him. The scene looked beautiful and painful. I tried to take a picture with my 35mm camera. Something got stuck and the picture didn't take. My dad said something like, "What did I tell you about taking them pictures? You can take them today, just today." He said this as I was walking out, trying to see what happened to my camera. All of a sudden, all of the film came out, but I could still see the images on them as if the film had already been developed. But for some reason in the dream, I knew that at some point the images would fade. In a later part, there was a doctor there who, for some reason, seemed like he was trying to get away from my dad. He was a white doctor with dark brown hair, looked like he could be in his late 30s or something. My dad went up to him and said, "Never in my life have I said something like this, but doctor, do you think this disease is after me?" The doctor shrugged him off and said, "No, I've got to get home." In my journal, I had also written about my father's second of what would eventually turn out to be 9 visits to the ICU in his last 9 months of living. There is one note in particular that I wanted to read, and it was from a moment when my father was coming out of being heavily sedated after having a seizure from being given the wrong medication. At the head of the journal entry, there's a title that I had wrote. It says, "Things I want to write about and will try to, so I'll list them here to hold myself accountable." It was written on March 9th, 2019. And one of the notes, a part of the list, says, same day, my father says in a serious tone, I got 8 boxes. 5 of them are in the basement. Now, between the 4 of us, I think we could get a good start. We, being my mother, my brother, and myself, all agree. And then I ask, what are we putting in the boxes? He says, sincerely, anything we want. The last dream I'll mention. We had my father's burial separate from the memorial service. The burial happened on a Monday, and shortly after, I took a flight back to New York, which admittedly was my attempt to flee what felt like the most consuming darkness I have ever been made to stomach. That night, I had what I soon found out was a visitation dream. I was, for some reason, in a leprechaun costume and was in a place that partly looked like the backyard of the house I grew up in the suburbs of Cleveland, and the office where I worked at the time in New York. I was riding on a bike, and then a little girl came up to me to give me some silver coins. She did it apologetically, which I didn't understand at first, but when she walked away, I realized that maybe it was because leprechauns usually want gold. I took the coins, rode my bike to the backyard and into the garage. I immediately, slowly rode back out, looking around, searching for something that I thought I dropped. And then all of a sudden, I see a car, the same kind of car my dad drove, slowly drive up the driveway. As soon as I see it, I rejoice and say out loud, ah, yes, that's it. It being the thing I thought I had dropped. As the car comes closer, I see the wheel turning, keys shaking, but no one in the driver's seat to initiate these movements. When I notice this, I can really see the sun in a way that I had ignored before. I start to move from the passenger seat window and walk towards the driver's window. And when I went from the front of the car to the driver's window, I saw something that was almost like a swiping motion. And my father appeared in the driver's seat. He was wearing the all brown uniform he would wear to work as a garbage man. I don't remember exactly what I said, but it was something like, Dad, where did you go? Where have you been? What are you doing? What happened? And I remember so clearly him looking me in the eyes and saying, I have given enough breath to this life. And then the dream ends and I wake up stunned. Photography, in essence, concerns itself with light, surface, and time. What we know to be true of a photograph is that it contains a moment, whether it's the right moment or wrong moment or painful moment, it holds a happening. When looking at an image that's blurred, another common term that's used to describe this phenomenon is out of focus, suggesting that there was something to see in clear view, but this thing, the photograph, isn't revealing all that there is. We look at it with this belief, I know there is more there. When me, my brother, and mother had to check my father's body and his casket before the memorial service, I couldn't help but think that is not my father. My experience of viewing his lifeless body was a moment of blur. I protested. This could not be my father because this is not it. This is not all. I know there is more to him. And that's when I fully realized that there is so much to living and being a part of the world that will remain outside of what can be seen, even if I feel like I should be able to see it or feel that I can see it. And for me, I feel this is a way to define spirituality and the kind of spirituality that is inherent to image making. I found and experienced a kind of blur in the moment my father spoke about the imaginary boxes that he planned to fill with me, my brother, and mother. I also found it in the dream, or really nightmare, of my father being shrugged off by the white doctor, leaving him to the ills of his disease, to which I desperately tried to capture on my camera. I found it in the visitation dream, the day we buried my father, the slow reveal of him sitting in the driver's seat in a car that I was sure I had lost myself, telling me there was no more breathing for him to do in this life. I can't help but relate the blur to the experience of grief, trying to force the love you have for someone who was once here and is no longer, or at least not in the way your vision is used to, and I mean a kind of spiritual vision, a vision of the heart, trying to force that love to create what was once here, what I feel should still be here in full, clear view. Before reading the title of this photograph, I knew it was an image of Amiri Baraka. The tilt of the head, the subtle detail of the eyes and mustache. And again, it makes me return to this belief of when viewing a photograph that contains blur, that there is this belief that there's more to be seen, there's more there because of the details that you are able to recognize. But Ming Smith uses the blur in a way where it feels like a special space of knowing, a private, sacred space. The kind of space Amiri Baraka creates in his poem, SOS, where he calls all the Black people to come in for safety. As Ellington said, his jazz is not jazz. It is not piano or ideas. It's dreaming. It is something that comes from within, a kind of spirit, thus making the listening to his music or his dreams a spiritual moment. Ming Smith's work is of the same religion. It is the poetry of Blackness. And I mean that in every sense of the word. Poetry rendered in movement, light, darkness, texture, blur, to which it all becomes song. At the end of Street of Dreams by Sarah Vaughan, the jazz vocalist, Sarah dips down in that last push of eames in the word dreams. That downward fall in melody is unsuspected and feels sort of out of reach of how I thought the song would end. To me, it feels like a blur in a photograph, and a blur in this context of vulnerability, respect of feeling, and protection from the possibility of being surveilled.
I'll go, silver and gold, all you. Long as love is sure on the street of dreams.
that's all.
Thank you, Shala.
I'm going to pass it to Erica.
Yeah. Wow. Thank you so much. And now all the panelists can join me back on screen. I am so lifted by these offerings and feeling a lot of things. Gabrielle, you really electrified us with your performance. Thank you. Got us up out of our seats. And Kenturah, it accounts for the air is something that I'm going to keep thinking about for the rest of our time together. And as I continue to do some writing about Ming's blur. But Shala, I want to say to you, my father died a year ago. May 1st is the day that he passed. And so your reflections really hit me in a really magical way. It felt kindred. And I'm grateful for your offering on the way we grieve fathers and those dreams, those visitations, because I had a lot of those too. So thank you.
Thank you for saying that.
Yeah. We have some questions here that I'm going to read through, but I'm also interested if you all want to reflect anything back from what you heard or anything that is hitting you before we dive in.
I have a couple things. The immediate thing off of what Shala shared is thinking about what's not seen as much as what is seen, and how blur points to things at the edge of our perception. Mm-hmm. And so that's something that's really engaging to me as someone who works from photography, but also as a viewer, that I find myself in front of an image like that, like the ones you shared, and obviously Ming Smith's work as extending what's in the photo in the mind with thinking about what's not there or what's invisible, or even mm-hmm. how the blur and the nature of making the long exposure shifts mm-hmm. from the edge of perception to bringing things to the surface that we wouldn't notice if not for the blur.
Mm-hmm.
I want to add to that, because I feel like both of you spoke so beautifully to that idea. And Kenturah, when you talked about the blur as a witness to periphery, that mm-hmm. was powerful to me. And thinking about it as something that accounts for periphery, I'm also really appreciative of how you brought in the quantum and the idea of energy and momentum and light, and the idea that when you turn on a light, you know, that the furniture slightly moves. There's something in that slight movement that feels very akin to how I experience what's going on in Ming's photos as well. So I wanted to thank you for that. And I mean, and Shala, I just thank you for the way that you integrated music so powerfully and dreams. Yeah, very inspiring.
Thank you. I also, going off of what you just said, Gabrielle, I want to thank the both of you. And first, Kenturah, to echo what Gabrielle just said, you had also said something about shadows as the architecture of the visual field. And I was thinking so much about shadows as, you know, or thinking about how light is so necessary in photography and image making. And then because there is light, there also is shadow. And just thinking about shadow as architecture, the way that you said it, was it just felt so perfect in this conversation around the blur and thinking of it as like a kind of political tool within image making. And then also, Gabrielle, what you had said about thinking about documentation, or you had said something about this being, or video being, the what happens looks like, and uh-huh. how the blur isn't blurry. I love that play of language, the what happens. But again, it feels like there was a kind of space that was introduced in between the what and the what happens, and that felt like how we're talking about with the blur here. So thank you to the both of you.
Thank you.
Thank
the
you.
Space between the what and the what happens, what happens looks like. That is a blur, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that remark I made about the world itself and how we perceive it, and there always being that gap, mm-hmm. and that how we understand ourselves and our in the world, like you said, is a blurred experience. It's always mediated by something, mm-hmm. whether it's our own body and what we have to sense the world, or whether it's tools that we've made or find. Mm-hmm.
So in that way, the blur is not so much like illegible as illuminating.
Yes.
Because it's showing the thing that gets passed over, that in between space, as you said so powerfully, it accounts for the air.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. I think it's interesting too, to consider the process of creating the blur, the long exposure. And what I really enjoyed, Kenturah, is how we were able to get a bit of your process and how it was connected to your relationship with Lauren and your friendship, and how even your work was documenting that relationship, that the blur documents that relationality, similar to the circular breathing photograph, that air, the accounting of the air is quite evident. But then we also have these unexplained moments. Just, there's so much in this one image, but the look in Bibbs's eyes, mm-hmm. and wondering what might have happened before, wondering what the conversation was to incite this image, how long had they been there? I think thinking of circular breathing in parallel with your process is really fascinating. And I'd love to hear more about process in particular. This is me not using the question that I have given you all, and this is me riffing, because you all really brought up, you brought the dust up. So it's time to look at this and look at what we've been talking about. And so, similar to you, to process, also Shala and Gabrielle, I'm interested in, for you, Shala, this sort of associative, the dreaming and bringing the dreams that you had surrounding, because that is such a specific period, being near to death, close to death, and then being sharing that documentation. And Gabrielle, one of our early conversations involved you talking about sequins, and spirit and the blur as even the sequins specific to, yes, exactly. So I'm curious if we can dive into that specific to this a Haitian dance that you were mentioning. You can correct me if I'm wrong, but I'm wondering if we can get into that process.
So thinking, just to clarify your question, thinking about like blur related to creative process, or
yeah,
how that
exactly. For all three of you, yeah. If, and whoever wants to, I started with Kenturah, but whoever wants to dive in, the way it's specifically how you work, how you took those images of Lauren, and then what that process was for you and that relationship.
Yeah. So I mean, something that actually came up that I've not stopped thinking about when we talked prior, before really encountering the work, Circular Breathing and the title, I never really thought about my own breath when making a photograph. I have a ton of musician friends. So there was a period of time where I spent a lot of time going to shows. And of course, that's evocative of a lot of Ming Smith's practice, is being in these dark spaces, trying to make make an image. And, you know, if you understand the way a camera works, there's like a point to which you can't help, unless you have like a tripod or something, your image is gonna be blurry. If it's slower than 1/60th of a second, I think you can count on some blur when you shoot the image. So there's this kind of stillness and kind of consciousness about slowing your breathing, so you're not moving, so you can kind of render an image that Again, I've not been able to stop thinking about my own breath and making the photos. But to speak specifically about the images with Lauren, you know, that was around the time where I really began embracing the blur, because all the images I make share an extended duration of time with friends. And it seemed significant to kind of index that, but also the fact that it's like an image that's inherently destabilized. Mm-hmm. And another thing that happens that I'm quite aware of in encountering a blurry image is that there's a difference between how you see it up close and at a distance. At mm-hmm. a distance, your eyes are trying to bring it into focus, but then the closer you get, the image falls apart. And so I love that idea of like, you're intimate with an image that is not necessarily returning a kind of legibility to you. So it's this weird kind of push and pull that happens. And so that's an experience that's in the making of the photos too.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Shala, did you want to add anything to that?
Yeah, I also just wanted to quickly highlight what someone just shared in the chat about Ahmad Jamal, who is one of my favorite musicians who, yes, just passed away. And someone left a very lovely comment about how he revolutionized jazz by taking out the guitar and putting in the piano. So yes, thank you for that, Francie. But to speak to the blur, or what you were asking, Erica, about using dreams, and for me, in the wake, I mean, almost immediately in the wake of my father's death, my relationship to dreaming radically changed because of this, the first visitation dream. Dreams for me, or at least especially these dreams with my father, kind of became a place of information for me. And when I first began photographing, my first subjects were my mother and father. And it was mostly out of, you know, access, because they were right there. I was very shy. I didn't have a lot of friends as a kid. But then it soon grew to be a kind of obsession of wanting to have an archive of my mother and father, because I kind of knew that I would lose, especially my father, because he was sick my whole life. I knew I would lose them eventually. So it was really truly like this sort of anticipation of loss in some way. And I wanted to have as much as I could to hold on to that relationship, that person. And so as my father was drifting in his last few months of life, I kind of realized the impossibility of holding on to him in full. And you know, there doesn't matter how many pictures, videos, journal entries that I write, it will never be enough to render him back to being here with me in the world. And I don't know, I think that for a long time, and even to this day, I have my moments where I get really frustrated with that lack of clarity, with that experience of the blur. And then other times I really embrace it as, you know, as like a kind of protection of him and me, I guess, in a way. The fact that, you know, he is no longer here in the physical world, and in many ways shouldn't be, because he was really sick. So I just, there's also something about the act of dreaming that you know, is really interesting to me, because it is rooted in a kind of lived reality, but the space of dreaming on its own. It's like its own kind of logic, its own kind of way of storytelling that feels very removed from what we may know to be logical in our waking life. And that space in between feels also akin to the way that we're thinking and talking about the blur in photography. So I do, especially now again, like, you know, mourning my father, I am trying to embrace that within my life and, you know, naturally in my practice or using my practice, it's a way for me to really make peace with it, I guess, in some way.
Thank you, Shala.
That was so beautiful. I'm still thinking about things that both of you said. Before I forget, though, I want to say happy birthday to Mr. Bill May, because I mean, I feel like a goal of mine personally is to celebrate my 77th birthday. So thank you for modeling that for me. You mentioned the sequins, and I think for me, I was thinking about like Duapo flags and Vodun, and I was thinking about bottles, and I was thinking about things that are faceted in very small little, almost like tiny pixels, but not photographic pixels, almost like literal pixels that are materialized and sewn very painstakingly. And then they move, the blur arrives through movement, right? So one of the things I've really enjoyed in terms of collaborating and learning from all of you working in photography is just how kind of the medium of photography works and the places where it seems like it intersects with performance and then the places where it feels like it's having its own, it's within its own kind of sphere, right? So when I think of blur in terms of artistic process for me in the realm of performance, I think about motion, of course, and often that feels like speed, but it's not always speed. And what's interesting is that kind of stemming from the part of my heritage that is Haitian, I think about trance, for example, which is not always fast. You know, trance doesn't have to be fast, but there is an inducement of blur. So I made a performance in 2021 on Zoom, and then did it again. I've done it live maybe once. It's so funny. But anyway, part of what happens is that I kind of put myself through repetition and movement into an altered state. Mm-hmm. And that kind of altered state for me is a blur, you know? Mm-hmm. And it becomes a source of some other kind of energy, and it pushes time in a very specific way. And it can be something that frustrates a viewer or mesmerizes a viewer or invites a viewer or prepares a viewer for something, for a different kind of engagement. And I think that when I think about that in the performance realm, and then I return back to Ming Smith's photographs, I'm like, oh yeah, I see that. That's preparing us all for another kind of way of looking, another kind of way of thinking, another kind of way of engaging time, and also thinking differently about speed, you know, yeah, or movement. And so that feels exciting to me. Those are some things I'm thinking about.
Thank you. Thank you for that. I'm going to echo back to you. The blur arrives through movement. I love that. And I'm going to let it kind of bring us into that first actual question, the blur as embodiment, thinking about Ming as a dancer, mm-hmm, in addition to being a jazz photographer, the sense of movement and physicality also in all of your work. Kenturah, a study of entanglements, you described, your work was described as dance writing, and I love thinking about it that way, that embedded movement. And Gabrielle, in your interview with David Naiman for Between the Covers, you described your performances as embodied poems and an attempt to bring yourself into a kind of presence. Mm-hmm. I love the phrase, bring myself into a kind of presence, kind of side by side with dance writing, thinking about how the embodied poems are dance writing as embodied poems. And Shala, in Tender Noted, you have these sections where they're scripts. And for me as the reader, I kept reading out loud. I kept opening my mouth and saying the dialogue out loud. And so I'm interested in this and how the blur is a form of embodiment, this aesthetic principle within your work, within Black feminist creative practice, just how this could be a space of resonance. Mm. And whoever wants to get us started, just jump right in.
I can just say quickly that I love that you mentioned that word presence, and I feel like I just wanna talk about how presence and visibility are not the same thing.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. That's what the blur helps us understand a little bit, you know? So I know one of the things that you've talked a lot about in terms of thinking about Ming's work is notion of opacity and thinking about glissant and protection and the need not to be fully transparent as but a way to render knowledge and a knowledge of mystery or recognition of a kind of mystery. And I think right. that what does it mean to think about an embodied presence? That's what I love personally about performance art making, that it taught me that it wasn't about what my body looked like. It was about what my body was doing.
Mm.
So I'll hold it there and pass it to one of my esteemed colleagues.
And by the way, the slides we're seeing are excerpts from the work I've been referencing. So this is Gabrielle's poem, These Bodies Don't Touch, from the Deja Vu, her most recent collection. And before that, we were seeing pages from Shala's book, Shala Miller's book, Tender Noted. And then soon we'll rotate back to see, here's Tender Noted. And then soon we'll see more images of a study of entanglements.
Mm.
Who would like to?
Yeah, I was just about to jump in and say, I love what you just said, Gabrielle, about presence and visibility is not the same thing. And I was thinking about that too, but didn't fully have the language for it as I was thinking about trying to align the experience of grief with this usage of blur within the photographic context or world. And just to echo what I had mentioned before in my presentation, it was so interesting to me about the blur or noticing the blur in photography again is I feel like our experience of photography is like, or photography has its own reality. There's like photography reality and then a sort of lived reality. And I feel like the way that we experience images, we at this point have certain assumptions of what they are meant to do. And usually we think of images as like either documenting something or sometimes even revealing something or being proof of a moment. And I think what is interesting about that, taking that idea or, you know, supposed thing that photography does, and then, you know, especially intentionally blurring or using long exposure within photography, and having this moment of like forcing the viewer to or at least like the viewer wondering or questioning or thinking that there is something there that should be in clear focus. Mm-hmm. And wanting to make something that is already present, you know, in the photograph in a sort of spiritual sense, but is not, you know, visible, you know, not in clear view. And I don't know, I like think about that in the experience of grieving someone, you know, when people say like they're with you, and sometimes I can be very like a cynic and like kind of protest that, like, what does that mean that they're with me in my heart? Like, I know I want them to be sitting next to me. And then other times I do really believe that, like, oh yes, my father is here. And that comes in moments of like the visitation dreams. And, you know, my father, like, it felt like him communicating to me something. but only doing so in this dream space. I don't know, but I that's what I'm thinking.
Yeah, Shala, that makes me think of mark making also, specific to your work as well, and to all of your work, the deliberate smudging and shading. Kitora, what did you want to add to that?
A couple of things. Slightly off topic, but the word protection has come up a few times, and being in the space of thinking about shadows, both the sort of kind of physical qualities and its metaphors, I'm remembering like all these kind of biblical scriptures about coming under the shade of my wing or something. Mm-hmm. So shade offering a kind of protection. Mm-hmm. So again, shifting and disrupting things that we normally attribute to shadows and darkness. I'm kind of sitting in, with this like shadows as protection. And I think part of the reason this is shadows is coming up a lot for me is, you know, often when I'm working, a kind of progression in the work happens when I unpack what I've already been doing. And so I'm making the photograph thinking about it being a record of the shadow, conditions of the shadow in the space. I've just tried to push that in a way. Right behind me, and I know it came up in the slides, are a couple of the works that have been referenced, Fall and Recover, and then Contending with this Mirroring. Okay, Contending with Contingency is another, a couple of pieces where I explicitly, I went to a friend who's a dancer and photographed her moving, a couple of friends, photographed them moving, and using that as a way to kind of think through the parallels of like what kind of, how is language like shadows? And thinking about how shadows is always contingent to light and what's happening in the space, and thinking about language and how we use it, everything's contingent on the context. And so meaning shifts in a different kind of context. So I made these drawings with a kind of moving figure and thinking through the sort of parallel in language about how meaning always shifts depending on the context that it's in. This, what we're looking at now, Fall and Recover, a horizon of the same figure, the same person moving in different positions. And the surface is paper that's been embossed with a kind of kaleidoscope of text, another kind of essay that I wrote. And so if you think about a kind of embossing, it's a mark that in a way is there, but not there. It's only visible to us because of its shadows. And then, so first embossing the paper, then I go in and render with a kind of dark kind of carbon pencil on top. And so it's really bringing to the fore this idea that darkness is offers a kind of illumination. So where I rub the pencil, that's when the text becomes the most visible. Where you can see the text once you get up close to it, it's the shadows, it's the darkness that's offering a kind of set of information. So in thinking about movement and choreography, these works kind of animate what's and pushes what's happening all the time. We're encountering each other in motion, and everything, what happens, the decisions we make, is all tied to the context that we're in. So again, in a way, accounting for the air.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Mm. That's what I was just thinking. I mean, your work certainly accounts for the air. In our last 5 minutes, are there any final thoughts before we bring Betty Carter on?
I just want to say thank you again to all of you. You're so brilliant. And I have so much, I've just been taking notes this whole time, and I have so much to think about and bring into my own writing and making.
Yes, I want to say thank you too. This was really wonderful. And thank you to everyone in the chat too. I've been looking and also really generous comments in the chat.
Thank you as well, ditto. I've got a lot to walk away from. I mean, we got a chance to talk beforehand and some of those things are like still kind of singing in my head, but watching and hearing what you all shared creates this sort of embrace in the things that I'm thinking about and hadn't thought about and now I feel like are gonna be integrated into the work.
Yeah, totally.
Thank you all so much for being so open to the process and to thinking this through. I love what you said, Gabrielle, about let's look at our blurs. That really feels resonant individually and collectively. We've done that in a really special way this evening. And I agree, Kenturah, these are pages of prompts that I'm gonna be writing through for the next couple weeks. Mm-hmm. Thank you everyone for joining us, for taking your Tuesday evening to be with us. Thank you again to MoMA in studio and to Ming Smith for really inciting this really inspired conversation. And let's bring Betty Carter's Daydream on and we can slowly ease our way up.
Yay, Betty.
I don't even want to interrupt, so I'm going to say this really, really, really quickly so we can continue to focus on the music, but I just want to collectively just thank Erica and Gabrielle and Kenturah and Shayla and the entire MoMA and studio teams on the back end, as well as our captioners and ASL interpreters, and thank you everyone for joining us this evening. One plug, the third program in the series, Slow Looking, on Ming Smith with Jennifer Sterling, will take place on Zoom on May 17th and 18th. For more information, please visit Studio or MoMA's websites. And please, please, if you find yourself in New York before May 29th, please go see Projects Ming Smith in person. We're going to free part of tune in to music. And if I could just get a collective like amen from the church, I know we didn't really get to let you come into the conversation, but just to let us know that you were here and that you were present, amen. Thank you. I appreciate all of you so much. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Amen.
Amen. Love to all of you. Beautiful. Thank you.
funny's the way that I feel now. Can't keep my feet on the ground. Building a castle there. For me, till I find that he is daydreaming. Thank you.
just like me.
Thank you.